All right, so I'm going to engage in some integrated marketing communication for the UCO chapter of the American Marketing Association. I have a promotional video that we created a number of years ago when I first started coaching the AMA and sponsoring the AMA team to the ICC, the International Collegiate Conference in New Orleans. So I'm going to show you this promotional video. We can talk about what you think about it in terms of IMC. And then we'll also talk about some opportunities for you on the other side. So I'm going to play that. I hope you enjoy it. I think we did a pretty good job in creating it. And we'll see what you all think. I'm pitching this today. I'm going to engage in creative personal selling and integrated marketing communication. A series of unfortunate events has happened to our UCO AMA chapter, which has resulted in two of my officers having to leave unexpectedly, and so I'm looking for people who want to be officers, and that guarantees you, if you take those two officer spots, that guarantees you the trip to ICC in New Orleans in April, and that's all paid for by the school. So the school pays your airfare, the hotel, and most of your meals while you're there, and the conference registration fee. We usually go the day before the conference and we stay until the day after. We're one of the most generous schools in terms of the student travel that we have. So we use some of your student fee money to sponsor and support these programs, and it's your opportunity, you've given us a lot of money, to get some benefit back to you and actually go and compete at the AMA, ICC in a sales competition or a case competition or the chapter plan, chapter reporting competition. And again, the school pays for all of your transportation, travel, hotel, and most of your food. We also pay for one excursion. So in years past, we've done things like we've gone to either the Audubon Aquarium in New Orleans or we've gone to the Audubon Zoo. Last year, I wanted to go on a swamp tour with the students, but it was during a hurricane and it was flooding, and so there was no swamp tour available. So we went up to Baton Rouge and we started on Plantation Row along the Mississippi River, and we visited three plantations, so we did a little history. It's a really good opportunity to learn something else. And if you've never been to New Orleans, it's one of two cities in the United States that most culinary experts have said have a completely unique and distinct culinary flavor. One of only two that is absolutely unique. So it's a Creole experience in terms of culinary delight. And the other city is Santa Fe, New Mexico, the city that I was born in. And so it's a really good opportunity for you if you want to talk to me after class about that. I'm happy to talk to you about UCO's AMA, and I hope that you guys will seriously consider. There's another way that you can get involved is get on the sales team, so become a sales major or a sales minor. Take professional sales and then advanced professional sales, and that qualifies you to compete for slots on the sales team. That is more competitive, I will tell you, every year if you want to travel. This one is, I have a harder time filling these slots. The sales team slots, we have absolute, you know, a plethora of people that try out for those. But this is one that I have more control and more flexibility with. So if you're not interested necessarily in being a sales professional, this is the department's other opportunity for you to participate. The reason that I think that it's important for you is not just that you get a really good trip out of it, and you learn a lot of stuff and you get to experience the conference and learn about being a marketing professional. But it's also as you go out and you build your brand and you think about engaging in integrated marketing communication for yourself to get a job, and you should start thinking of yourself as a brand. This is one way to distinguish yourself from other people. We are largely a commuter school, and so students who graduate with degrees from UCO have a tendency to not be as involved in campus activities as schools like OU or OSU, which have a traditional resident sort of campus population, because most of our students have to work and they're working adults and they have to come. They don't necessarily get all of the opportunities to engage in campus activities that they should. And that is one of the things that employers will look at when you go out into the job market is, did you do and were you active in things in college? Did you do something beyond just the classroom? And this is an opportunity to engage in transformative learning and build that sort of unique aspect to your resume. And I highly encourage you to do that. So two opportunities that we have in the marketing department are the sales team and UCO's AMA. So if you're interested, why don't you give me a shout after class and I'll be happy to talk to you about that. Since some of you are not talking and less hesitant to or more hesitant to participate, I have decided to try something different in here. I'm going to use a Mentimeter presentation for today, so hopefully this will work. I've never tried it here.
What type of presentation is that?
So what you're going to do is you're going to go on your devices, your either your laptop or your phones, and go to Mentimeter.com and enter the code 2035-03. And this is going to allow you one. So as we go through here, you can give me thumbs up, thumbs down. You can hit the question mark and I'll see that pop up on the screen. You can tell me that you're just absolutely loving the presentation, which I'm sure you will. All of you will give me lots of hearts and good feelings, or you can throw a cat at me. I don't know really what that means. Perhaps one of you can tell me what the cat emoticon means on these kinds of presentations.
It depends on which one it is.
It's just a cat. You can see it right down there at the bottom. So what does it mean?
It's Anybody else? Like, if it were a Rotten Tomato, I would understand that, but.
Can we just put, get started?
So just go to menti.com, I'm sorry, menti.com, not menti meter, menti.com, and 2035-03. What does the cat mean? Anybody? What does it mean?
Oh, it says on here, the cat is just for fun.
Just for fun.
I was thinking of that word for it.
All right, so we're gonna talk about integrated marketing communication strategy. So marketing strategy and analysis. And your text, this is one of the things that they say, you know, you're gonna look at your strategic plan. Well, that assumes that you have one. So somebody's already sent me a cat. Thumbs up. I'm feeling the love already. So that's great. That assumes that you have a plan. Lots of businesses, and particularly, and one of the things I think that we need to think about in here is small to medium-sized businesses. Most of you will go to work in small to mid-sized businesses. That's going to be typical. The days of going to work for the big corporation and staying there for 20 years is long gone, and drawing attention is something of the past. That's not to say that some of you won't go to work, and particularly if you're going into sales, a lot of you will go to work for major publicly traded companies like Gartner and stuff like that. But there are also a lot of opportunities in mid-sized businesses. One of the ones that sponsors, for example, a lot of the competitions like ICSC is Tom James. And that's a mid-sized business. They're a custom manufacturer of high-quality clothing for men and women, custom-made. And so there are lots of opportunities in those segments as well, and a lot of you will do that. And a lot of these small to mid-sized businesses don't actually have a strategic marketing plan. So I think you have to recognize that what you have to do is we need to develop a strategic marketing plan. So how are you going to develop that? What is going to be the development in the strategic marketing plan? Well, it's going to be developed from your overall corporate strategy. Now again, a lot of small to mid-sized businesses, I don't know that they necessarily know what their overall corporate strategy is. So you really have to think about this, and this is not a trivial thing. In a classic work on marketing, Professor Levitt talks about the concept of marketing myopia. And what is marketing myopia? Anybody had me for principals should know what marketing myopia is. Nobody remembers what marketing myopia is. Completely forgot that one.
I didn't have me for marketing.
Yeah. You didn't have me for principles of marketing. I'm so sorry for you. You have an inferior academic.
I took online, so McGraw-Hill was my professor. I never actually talked to my professor.
All right. Well, I apologize.
So you
that's
well.
Awesome.
No, regurgitated exactly what McGraw-Hill told me what was marketing was. So.
Okay. Well, in a classic work, so if you go into a PhD program, one of the things you'll read is this classic, you'll read the classics in marketing literature, and one of them is called marketing myopia, and it's this idea that a lot of companies don't recognize, they get so focused on what they're doing in the minutia that they don't recognize the broader field. So if we went back to the turn of the century, a lot of the great companies at the turn of the 20th century, and getting beyond the turn of the 20th century enough, you know, we're into the 21st century, that people don't even think about it in many respects anymore. But if we went back to the beginning of the 20th century, which is largely when the Industrial Revolution really starts to take hold and there are radical transformations in our economy, moving from an agricultural economy to an industrial economy, and now we've moved from an industrial to a post-industrial economy, where the real value in our economy is in services and in those knowledge-based and knowledge-intense services. But if we went back all the way to 1900, a lot of the major companies in the country, the biggest companies in the country, were railroad companies. And a lot of them are no longer in business. It's not that railroad is unimportant, but a lot of them, there's not as many as there used to be. Rail is not the number one mode of transportation. In fact, there's a book by Rose George that's entitled 90% of everything. And if you ask people, if you go out and ask the average person, how many of the goods and services that you use every day arrived here by ship? Most people will say not much. A very small percentage of it. And the truth is that 90% of everything that you use, that you touch, that you wear, came over on a container ship. So railroads were important, they're still important, but what they didn't recognize is they were really good at running railroad companies, and they should have recognized that they were really in the business of what?
Transportation.
Transportation. In February, we'll come up on the largest buying day of roses in the United States. What day is that?
Valentine's Day.
Valentine's Day. And if you shipped roses by train or by boat, you're not going to get them in time for Valentine's Day. How are roses shipped? Where? So in February in Oklahoma, what season are we in the great Southwest plains here?
Winter.
It's winter. Roses growing in Oklahoma?
No.
No. What's the rose capital of this area, by the way?
In this region?
In this region, what's the rose capital?
Texas, South Texas?
It's in Texas. There's a rose capital. They call themselves the rose capital of the United States in Texas. Which town is it? Anybody know?
Paris, Texas.
You're close.
It's
not Paris, Texas. It's Tyler. Tyler, Texas, which is close to Paris, Texas. And if you've ever been to Paris, Texas, it's a horrible little town. I got stuck there one day overnight. It was just an absolute nightmare.
You mean you don't like the Eiffel Tower or the Cowboy Tower?
They didn't have an Eiffel Tower or Cowboy Hat. They had a Walmart that was horribly inefficient at the time.
I think there's so many Paris. So, Paris, Arkansas, too. They have a lot of
Do they really? Yeah. I didn't realize that.
A lot
so,
too.
The rose capital of the United States is Tyler, Texas, I guess. They don't have a lot of roses in February either, so where are those roses coming from? Well, they're coming from South America. How are they getting here? They're getting here by being flown in. That's why dozens, you know, a dozen red roses are so expensive in February, because they're flown in on airplane, and that's a less efficient and more expensive form of transportation, but it's absolutely critical and necessary if you're going to get roses in February for your insignificant other on Valentine's Day. The railroad company should have recognized that the bigger what they're in is actually the transportation industry. UPS is in transportation. UPS ships things by, they have train, they have truck, they have cars, they have airplanes. They, you know, they're in the transportation business. They're in the logistics business. And so they recognize that. So we really need to think about when we develop the overall corporate strategy, what business are we in? And I'll give you an example of this in my own family business. We started out, my mother owned a real estate company in Santa Fe, New Mexico, and she owned a construction company and an art gallery. And she decided that she wanted to spend more time at home with her kids. And so she was looking for a business that she could get into that would allow her to be home and still make a decent living. And so we opened the first bed and breakfast in Oklahoma in 1986. I was 13 years old at the time, and nobody knew what a bed and breakfast was in Oklahoma. That was not something that they had ever heard of before. And we were not instantly successful, so my mother started writing murder mysteries. And we began doing these life-size games of Clue. And if we had thought that we were just in the lodging industry, we would have gone broke. But she found out that what we were really in and what we could really make money at was being in the entertainment industry, in the hospitality and entertainment industry, not just in lodging. It's in being in the hospitality, tourism, and entertainment industry. And so we should think about not being myopic. Where does this come from? Well, what does the term myopic mean? Most people, by the way, are slightly, and you are getting more and more, your generation even more than mine, myopic. So what is myopic? What does the term myopic mean for five points? Tell me. You can look it up.
What was the question?
What does myopic mean?
Is it kind of like small picture complacency?
What does it literally mean?
Nearsighted.
Nearsighted. That's what it means. Nearsighted. So marketing myopia. We're extremely nearsighted. And why is it that your generation is becoming more. By the way, be sure and get me after class, so I'll get you your points.
Well, we said the same time.
Why are we becoming more myopic? Because, yeah, you're looking at these screens, and they're actually very hard on your eyes, and so we're actually developing as a result. Most people are sort of maybe genetically born slightly myopic, but we're becoming more myopic as a result of, they think, looking and staring at these phones, these devices, and these screens. So overall corporate strategy, based on a situational analysis, this is the situation, strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. And then we're going to identify market segments and target markets that we want to engage with and try to cater to. So, really important. And even small companies, as I've suggested, a lot of them don't do this because they're really focused on survival mode, but they really need, if you want to move beyond, and a lot of people say they want to be entrepreneurs and they don't necessarily know what entrepreneurship is. An entrepreneur is not just a business person. If you just want to start a business and not really grow it, that's not entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship is about growing your business. I know very few people actually state that explicitly. There was a guy in Guthrie who decided he wanted to make $30,000. When I first moved there in junior high, so he opened a donut shop and he figured out how many donuts he had to sell a day to make $30,000 in profit. And he opened the donut shop at 5 in the morning, and some days the donut shop was closed by 10, and some days it was closed by noon. He waited until he sold every last donut for the day and then closed the shop. Not the way I would run a business, but that's not entrepreneurship. That's just business ownership. Yeah.
Is it still around?
No. We have no donut shops in Guthrie anymore. At one point in time, we had three.
Yeah, Missy's.
They're not really just a donut shop. They have other stuff, but I guess they started. They said Missy's Donuts, so I guess we still have one donut shop.
I was wondering if that was it. It was
Daylight Donuts, and it was down on Oklahoma Street. So, identify segments and target markets. So, we're going to look at opportunities. What kinds of opportunities exist? Well, are there alternative markets for current products? If we talk about the product life cycle, for example, for Coca-Cola, where do you think Coca-Cola is in the product life cycle in the United States?
I think it's kind of towards the end.
Okay, so what's the product life cycle look like?
So it's kind of like it looks big and kind of goes down, unless there's a revive of the product.
Yeah. Okay. Depending on the type of product that you have, the product life cycles can look different, but generally speaking, it looks something like, and I hate this room because there's no board over there.
Would it definitely be in the maturity stage?
I think you were right the first time. I think it's in the decline stage. So, it looks something like this. There's an introduction, a growth, maturity, and then decline, right?
Would you say they're declining even though they're trying to become more healthier and like diet sodas that taste like fruit?
I think
Coca-Cola itself is a decline. I think their product, what they're doing is they are introducing new products to try and keep up. So I think in the United States, Coca-Cola is in the decline stage. Why is that? Because people recognize, as we have more information and better access to healthcare, that Coca-Cola is not a great product for you to be drinking. It's got as many calories if you are dieting. For example, what do they say you need to consider a meal if you're dieting? And this is one of the things that can happen in marketing, and it's one of the things that we have to think about in terms of ethics. We market a lot of things as health foods, and we think they have a health halo to them. And so we eat more than we should, maybe, because we think it's healthy, and it may not be healthy for us if you're eating more than a certain amount of it. So if you're dieting and you're trying to lose weight, which most of us probably should try to do. God knows I should. Since I broke my hip a year and a half, well, it's been almost 2 years now,
I haven't been able to go to the gym, and I've gained all kinds of weight, and I really need to now that it's almost fully healed, go back to the gym and start working out. But, you know, I've gotten out of the mode of it, and it's hard to do. But what's considered a meal if you're dieting? How many calories? Anybody know?
It's under 500.
It's under 500. You're right. You're close. It's 400 calories. How many calories are in a can of Coke?
230.
I don't know. It's all, and most people don't drink a can of Coke.
Right. I feel like that's
it's probably, you're probably close.
Can?
There's 250 in this bottle.
There's 250 in that bottle, which is a 20 ounce bottle.
Yeah. Which is probably similar in Coke-Cola.
So if you drink, so if you drink one of those bottles, you've got half the meal in terms of the caloric intake that they recommend right there. So I think Coca-Cola is in decline. Now, does that mean that they're not selling a lot of Coca-Cola? They are. Where are they finding alternative markets for their current product of Coca-Cola?
South America,
Latin America.
Well, they're also adding
China.
They're also adding the new healthier drinks that opens up a different section of the market in the U.S. Mm-hmm. So, like, you know, they're selling more to the healthy.
Yeah, I think Coca-Cola in the United States is in the decline. I think in some of the newly industrialized countries, like the first product that we sent to communist China after Richard Nixon opened China in 1972 was Coca-Cola. And there's a reason for that. There was something called the Coca-Cola Connection in a lot of White Houses, where it happened to be that a lot of Coca-Cola's executives in various forms, like their chief general counsel, became Attorney General Bell under the Carter administration. Secretary of State Vance in the Carter administration, and then a president and CEO of Coca-Cola. And so the first product we sent to communist China is Coca-Cola. And it's an iconic American brand, but in America I think it's in decline. In those newly industrialized countries where they don't have as much access to health care and as much knowledge maybe, it could be in a growth stage as it's being introduced in places like sub-Saharan Africa and others. Or it may be in the maturity stage, but I think clearly in the United States, Coca-Cola itself is in a decline, which brings us to the opportunity. So what is Coca-Cola having to do for the current market in the United States? It's what you suggested, and I'll give you bonus points for that. Be sure and see me after class. Coming up with new products for current markets. So the United States is a current market. We've become more health conscious. I never thought that we would pay more for a gallon of water, which we will now do. If you figure out what it costs, we would pay more for a gallon of water than we will pay for a gallon of gas. I never thought in my lifetime that would happen. It has now happened. So what has Coca-Cola done? As the bottled water products have become important, well, they've got their own bottled water brand, which is Dasani. They've started doing more in terms of sports drinks and health drinks and other types of things. And so if we look at Coca-Cola, Coca-Cola brands.
Yeah, I'm going to say a priority too. Yeah, they also came out with
a new one. I don't know. I've heard that their line of like Cokes or whatever that have like the kind of like what LaCroix's doing and like, the flavors and stuff. I heard that they're actually doing that good in the United States.
So if we look at the brands that Coca-Cola has, and those are just some. They used to do a better job of listing all of them. They've got a lot of different brands that are now under the Coca-Cola banner. What are they coming up with as an attempt to try and be more health conscious? Well, it's Coca-Cola Zero, Diet Coke, things that are less sugary. Now, it turns out that maybe some of these are not completely wonderful either, because a lot of the diet drinks have what?
Aspartame.
And that causes?
Cancer.
It could cause cancer. One of the things that they don't realize, that people don't realize, is that when you drink a diet drink, it has the same impact on your blood sugar levels as sugar does. So you're not getting the calories, but it can still cause, if you're type 2 diabetic, it can still cause spikes in your blood sugar levels. It has the same sort of masking effect. Yeah.
I've seen a lot of Diet Coke commercials lately, too, compared to just like regular Coca-Cola.
By the way, Diet Coke is far more popular now than the original Coca-Cola.
Really? The commercials are also terrible, kind of cringy.
So Diet Coke actually has a bigger brand footprint in the U.S. market because more and more people just recognize that they can't drink, you know, 200 and something odd calories in a 20-ounce drink. Because most of us don't buy cans anymore. We actually go for the 20-ounce bottle. There's a recognition that you don't need all of those calories, and so more people actually drink Diet Coke. Coca-Cola still has some brands, though, that they maintain, even though they are not advertising them. They're in the harvesting mode. They're in decline. Things like, how many of you have ever heard of, the first diet product out there was a diet drink called Tab. Anybody heard of that? It was still popular in the South, and they still sell it in the South in some places. They don't really market it very much. But Tab was the first diet drink. It was god-awful. But it still has a fairly strong loyal following, but it's definitely in decline. So there's all these other brands that Coca-Cola is trying to do to come up with new products for current markets. So these are just a few more that they have. They don't list Tab anymore, but they still have it. Minute Maid, Powerade, Smart Water, Mellow Yellow, Fuse Tea, Honest Tea, Fresca, things like that. So new products, another is the new products for new markets. So what are some of the new markets, for example, that we could bring new products to market for in the United States? What's a new and emerging market in the U.S.? Okay, what would be a new market though?
I'd say soccer is almost a new market.
Okay. People that are becoming interested in soccer is a new market. And you could market to them, if we're sticking with the Coca-Cola brand, by doing what?
The Powerade with zero calories, zero sugar.
Powerade, zero calories, zero sugar, and sponsoring soccer tournaments.
They sponsor a lot of Mexican teams.
That's right. One of the biggest emerging markets in the United States now are ethnic markets, as the ethnic populations have increased in this country. Texas will become minority-majority, I believe, in 2020, which is one of the reasons that Rafael Duardo Cruz is not doing as well as he had hoped, a deep red state, because Texas is becoming more blue, and so and that's largely as a result of immigration and a change in the demographics. So that could be a new market. What's another new market that's emerging? Well, as your generation is taking over the reins of industry, that's new marketing potential, right? As you gain more economic status, that could be seen as a new market, and we're going to have to develop new products. The generation that's coming up behind yours, which they're now labeling, I guess, Z, but they haven't come up with a really good name for it, is now entering the workforce. Those individuals are now entering college, and so that's a new market. And what kinds of products are they going to be interested in? I think we will continue to see a decline in sort of soft drinks and things that are not necessarily good for you. What is Coca-Cola, by the way, really wonderful for? Well, you can use it. Now think about this, folks. You can use it to clean the acid off of your battery cables on your car. And is that, like, think about what it's doing to the inside of your body. So new products for these markets that are more health conscious, that are more concerned with their, you know, lifestyle. We have to engage in competitive analysis. So if we look at strengths and weaknesses, those are internal, right, to the company or the business, and external are opportunities and threats. So what is the brand competition? Well, with regard to soft drinks, is there really not much competition in the soft drink? No, there's two major players in that. However, there are now emerging smaller companies that are selling their products regionally, particularly. Pops, if you go out to the gas station off of 2nd Street out in Arcadia, they have all of these different kinds of soft drink products that are being marketed, and there are some companies that are coming up. So what's the direct brand competition? Right now, the biggest direct brand competition, and it's been this way for about 60 years in the soft drink market in the United States, is between what? Two companies. There's Honest American red-blooded Coca-Cola and inferior communist Pepsi.
Would you consider 7-Up, because they're also kind of very independent, but they give Dr. Pepper rights to Pepsi at some place and Dr. Pepper rights to Coke.
Yeah.
So like, would you consider them competition or like partners?
I think they're, Dr. Pepper is largely, I think, isn't it a Coke print? Isn't it largely a Coke?
Well, it's product? A 7-Up, but they give it to Coke in certain markets.
So, I think the two biggest players are dominated by Coke and Pepsi. But yeah, they are, obviously. And there could be new and emerging soft drinks that come into the market. One of the things that's a alternative or a substitute for them are the make-your-own. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't know how popular those are going to be. I think that sort of is like the Keurig, in my opinion. I think that's a fad that came into the market and is not going to last very long. But you never know. Over time, as people maybe want that carbonation, but they don't necessarily want all of the sugar or the really the sort of bad or not as healthy for you sugar substitutes, those may actually become substantial competitors. So the direct brand competition, the indirect brand product substitutes like the ability to make your own soft drinks, the lesser brands that they have at Pops, maybe product substitutes. What gives Coke a competitive advantage? So what is a competitive advantage? It's something that your company does well. Well, what does Coke do well?
They advertise really, market well.
They advertise really well, they market really well. What else is a competitive advantage for Coke over communist Pepsi? Why is Coca-Cola actually more popular and tasty? So they did this years and years and years ago. They did what was called the Pepsi Challenge. And Pepsi would challenge people to take a blind taste test of Pepsi and Coke, and they overwhelmingly found that people preferred Pepsi to Coke. Now, the way they did that, I think they actually manipulated, and there's been a lot written about this, I think they actually manipulated results. There are a couple of ways they did it. First of all, there was some evidence that Pepsi was serving Pepsi cold. So it was a blind taste test, but Pepsi was being served cold, and Coke was being served at room temperature, which affects the taste, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Of the product, or at least the feel of the product. There was also evidence that people like sweeter tastes in small doses. So what were they giving you for the challenge? They weren't giving you an entire 12-ounce or even an 8-ounce glass of Pepsi and Coke and asking you to taste them and take the Pepsi challenge. They were giving you 1 ounce. And for 1 ounce, people like things that are sweeter more than they like less sweet. But over an extended period, so for 12 ounces, drinking an entire drink, most people preferred Coke to Pepsi over the long haul. Why is that? Because Coke is just less sugary sweet than Pepsi is. And so Coke, I think, you know, nobody knows what's totally in the Coke formula. It's what's called a trade secret. And I think that's a competitive advantage that they have. And we still have a lot of nostalgia for Coke. And there are still sort of cultural icons that are associated with Coke as a mixer for hard liquor and things like that.
Christmas.
Particularly at Christmas, there's this nostalgia that sort of surrounds Coke. And they did this by building a very strong brand in the market.
Well, and like to piggyback off of that, like there's people who use it like kind of like how people say I'm going to Google something. People say I'm going to go get a Coke as opposed to like pop or soda.
They use it for everything.
Yeah.
Which is one of the reasons why in the trademark area that Coca-Cola actually does a really good job of monitoring their trademark equity, and they will slam you, they will sue you for trademark infringement if you serve Pepsi products and you don't say, which is why if you go into any restaurant and they don't serve Coke products and you say, give me a Coke, they'll say, is Pepsi okay? And it's become ingrained in the culture for them to say that, because Coke would go out and they would sue you for trademark infringement and basically shut you down, because they did not want Coke to become a generic term for a carbonated, caffeinated soft drink product. That's what Coca-Cola is, right?
Cola is, by its definition, a caramelized, carbonated soft drink product. And so Coke did not want to become generic for that. You can lose your trademark, and Coca-Cola, by the way, for years and years and years, was the world's most valuable trademark. It was the most iconic trademark in the world. Now there is some evidence that in terms of brand equity, scholars have started to rank some other companies ahead of Coke, but I think this last year they actually made it back into the number one spot in terms of the most brand equity worldwide of any company. Coca-Cola did not want to lose their trademark, particularly in the United States, and there are ways that you can do that if you're challenged. And one of the famous cases in this area is a case called the Murphy Bed Company case. And what happened was Murphy Beds, and you all don't know what these are because you don't live in New York City, but if you do, they're actually popular and you can buy versions of them now through IKEA. There are these beds that fold up in the wall. New York City property values are enormously expensive. Apartments to rent are enormously expensive in New York City, which is why rent control has become a thing in New York City. And so if you have an elderly person who's been in their apartment for a long time, they can't just go ahead and raise the rent to be what market would be, because it would force a lot of people out of their apartments. As a result, apartments in New York are really, really small. I used to own a business that did healthcare recruitment, and one of my partners in that business lived in New York City. She'd lived in New York City all of her life. At the time that we started the business, I was 25, and she was 60-something. It was healthcare recruitment. She was a really good healthcare recruiter, but she'd lived in New York all of her life. And she came to Oklahoma to visit me, and I had bought my first home in Edgemere Park, and it was 1,600 square feet, 3 bedrooms, 2 full baths, had a formal living room, dining room, a pretty big kitchen, and it was a nice house, and I paid $125,000 for it. And she had just, as a 60-year-old woman, just bought her first condo, first apartment in a co-op in New York City, and she paid $1 million for it, and it was 950 square feet. And she was like, how much did you pay for, how can you afford this house? How many millions of dollars was it? And I was like, it was $125,000, and she couldn't believe that, because land and property is what? Cheap in Oklahoma. It's not cheap in New York City. But there were, as a result, there were lots of people in New York City and places like that that live in very small spaces, and that's sort of what IKEA is designed for, is the small space. And part of that is that a lot of people live in studio apartments, and so their entire life is in this apartment. They'll entertain in the apartment. And so they had these beds, which were called Murphy beds, which folded up into the wall so that you could have your living room and not, you know, when you had people over, they wouldn't be sitting on your bed, because it's kind of creepy to sit around in somebody's bedroom, right? So they have these beds called Murphy beds, and the Murphy Bed Company manufactured them. They became generic for a bed that folds up into the wall, into a cabinet in the wall. And they lost their trademark. And so Coca-Cola will, they police it. And if you serve Pepsi and not Coke, they will make sure that you say, we serve Pepsi, is that okay, not Coke, because they don't want it to become generic. Xerox, when I was growing up, was the number one brand of photocopier. And people would say, go make me a Xerox. And so Xerox did this whole advertising campaign that said, you cannot Xerox a Xerox on a Xerox, but you can make a copy on a Xerox copier, because they didn't want their brand name to become generic for a photocopied replica of an original. So competitive advantage. What does the firm do well? Coke has really protected their trademark. That's one of their competitive advantages. They protected their trademark really, really well. So segments. We're going to look at various segments. It's no longer that we can just produce one product for a mass market, that there's just one big market out there in the United States. So we can do market segmentation in a number of ways. The easiest and simplest ways are the top two, geographic and demographic. Then socioeconomic. These three you can find, basically geographic segmentation you can do by just looking around, sort of breaking the country up into regions. Now, it does become somewhat controversial. For example, what do you think we are in Oklahoma? What region of the country are we in Oklahoma?
What region of the country are we?
Yeah, what region?
Midwest.
You think we're Midwest?
I think we're technically Southwest.
I don't think we're Midwest. Okay. I don't think we have any, what is
sort of classic Midwestern.
They put candy and whipped cream and everything and mayonnaise and all that.
Well, I mean, what is like the tip, what is the iconic Midwestern city?
Oh.
What's the iconic Midwestern city?
You think Iowa?
Chicago. Chicago is Midwestern. Do you think we have anything in common with Chicago?
No.
We're not really Southeast.
I don't think we're Midwestern. So you think we're what?
I think we're Southwest.
I don't think we're Southwestern. You really think we're Southwestern?
We're Plains. Can we spell the Plains?
Because we're not Southeast either. We're not, you know, y'all.
Nope, we're not Southeastern. That's for sure. You think we're Southwestern? You think we have really that much in common with, for example, my home state, New Mexico, is very stereotypical Southwestern.
Yeah.
What do you think of when you think of Southwest?
Cactus.
Yeah.
You think of cactus, desert, Marlboro Man. These are sort of the images that come. Any of those, well, I guess Marlboro Man could apply to Oklahoma. Although we have more farmers than ranchers here. There's a whole skit in the play Oklahoma about the farmer and the rancher, right? How they should be friends. But I culturally, I think we're the closest that we come. Texas really considers themselves Southern. And I think culturally we're more like Texas than we are about any place else. In terms of getting along, the sort of the values that we have, I think we're more attuned with. Well, I lovingly and affectionately refer to Texas as Baja, Oklahoma. I'm sure they're horrified by that. But, you know, I think we have a tendency. Now, Texas is strange as well because their advertisements do say this. They're like a whole other country. West Texas is very different from East Texas. And you'll find that in Oklahoma. Western Oklahoma is very different from Tulsa and Eastern Oklahoma. And so it's hard to say what we are. I think we're probably more culturally, we have more in common with East Texas and Arkansas and Louisiana than we do New Mexico and Arizona and Utah and Colorado. I think that's just my impression, but I could be wrong. So I have a tendency to think that our cultural values, we tend to be more Southern. What's the number one denomination to this day in Oklahoma, although it's losing ground to the non-denominational churches, but Southern Baptist was the predominant denomination in Oklahoma and still is the predominant largest, I think, largest single denomination in the state. And where did the Southern Baptist come from? How did we get Southern Baptism? So what's the difference between a Southern Baptist and, say, a Free Will Baptist or a Northern Baptist?
You sit in the back.
It's in the what?
Oh, it's just backseat Baptists.
The backseat Baptists. Why are they called Southern Baptists? It actually goes along with the Civil War, and the Southern Baptist Convention started as a result of the embracing of slavery, as I understand it. I'm not a historical theologian, but so the Southern Baptist is a product of Southern United States. Free Will Baptist is probably the oldest Baptist denomination in the country. And so there are some differences, but the biggest denomination, and historically we were very churchy people in Oklahoma, was Southern Baptist. So I have a tendency to think we identify more with sort of Arkansas, Louisiana, and Texas than we do, like I said, New Mexico, Colorado, Arizona, Utah, Wyoming, which are clearly Southwestern culturally. So it's a little bit touchy, but geographic is probably the easiest way. You can just look at a map and sort of figure out that there are differences. One of the things that they did when I was getting my PhD at New Mexico State was they did a survey of fourth graders and they asked them where you're most likely to see a boat. And in Las Cruces, New Mexico, fourth graders overwhelmingly said that they were most likely to see a boat on the highway. Why is that? There are almost no lakes in southern New Mexico. There are not a lot of boats, so the only time they saw boats was when they're going through on the way to Elephant Butte, which is about 2 hours north of Las Cruces, or someplace else, but they didn't see a lot of boats. So if you asked an Oklahoma kid in the fourth grade where they're most likely to see a boat, what are they going to say?
The lake.
Because that's where you put boats here, is on the lake. If you ask a kid in Florida, where are you most likely to see a boat?
They're going to say what?
Gulf of Mexico.
The ocean. Yeah, the Gulf of Mexico or the Atlantic Ocean.
Yeah.
But there are boats, of course, on Lake Okeechobee and the various lakes there, but that's where you're most likely to see a boat. So there are differences in geography that we can use as market segmentation. If you go going along with the boat theme to the Yamaha dealer in Las Cruces, New Mexico, they will not carry, and they did not carry, I actually went there and looked to make sure this was true when I was there, they didn't carry wave runners. They would order them if you wanted them, because there was a lake 2 hours north of Las Cruces called Elephant Butte, which is the ugliest mud hole in the desert that you've ever seen in your entire life. You really don't want to go there, but they would order them. They did not keep them in stock. What did they have in Las Cruces, New Mexico? Well, there's lots of open space that's owned by the government around New Mexico in the desert, and you can do what?
Four-wheel.
You can quad. Yeah, they had a lot of quads, a lot of side-by-sides, things like that were very popular in Las Cruces. If you go to the Yamaha dealer here in Oklahoma City, they're going to carry a whole lot of wave runners, because we have a whole lot of public bodies of water. We have less land, although there is some land that you can ride quads on. In western Oklahoma, there's the great sand dunes up there, that the salt plains that you can go. There's a place sort of south of Norman, but we have a lot of wave runners. Demographic is the next way. So geographic is easy to do market segmentation. You can look at things like, well, there's no water in New Mexico, so we're not going to sell a lot of wave runners. We're going to sell a lot of quads. Maybe not necessarily the most powerful way of market segmenting, but it is obviously useful. Demographic, you can get a lot of this information from, in terms of basic demographics, for free. The United States government compiles it. They're going to do that not very long from now, and something called the
census,
which is taken every 10 years, and it provides us with all kinds of wonderfully rich demographic information. And so you can begin to market, and you can build segments on demographics. Yeah.
So for a place like Texas or even Oklahoma, the census is pretty off in the last 8 years, because there's been so much like immigration, just so many things have changed. So what would you do to fix that? Because if you go off census numbers, it's going to be slightly off of what you try to predict and try to market.
The census does a couple of things. First of all, they update it. They do the Census Bureau. There is a big census, which is actually not a census. It's a really big survey, but we call it a census because it's impossible to get actually every single. So it is a really big sample of the population, because it's impossible to get everybody. Why is that? Well, for example, homeless people generally they're hard to find. Now, there are census takers that actually go out and do that. They actually go and try, and they look under bridges and they try to count people, but it's imperfect. There are people that will not answer the door for the census takers, so they're going to move the census online. But they do samples, and they update that, and they take various samples throughout the 10-year period in between the big and modify the numbers and the projections. And there are ways of statistically looking at that, making sure that those numbers are valid.
Okay.
So there are, between those 10-year periods, there are ways that they update the census population. They generally post the census population like on community signs, you know, every 10 years, and that's when we reapportion congressional districts every 10 years. We redraw the congressional districts and the state legislative districts. But they do update that, and so they have estimates. They have census estimates every year for demographic changes. So one of the things that we know, for example, in between the last census and the next census, so the last census was in what? 2010, and the next big census will be 2020. One of the things that we know is that there's been a huge change in demographic trends in this nation, even in that 10-year period that they have predicted. Where are the demographic trends moving? Well, people are moving out of places like Iowa and North Dakota and Nebraska, and they're moving to places like where? Texas, Louisiana, Florida, Southern New Mexico. Why?
It's cold.
It's cold in Nebraska. And
old.
As they get older, they're moving, they're becoming snowbirds and moving further south. So there's been a huge population trend. The population of the United States used to be more evenly distributed. Now, something like within the last 20 years, one of the demographic trends that we've seen is that the vast majority of the population, by the way, lives within 600 miles of a coast. So the middle of the country and the north parts of the country have emptied out and they've started to move south. And that's been particularly true as people retire. And they move out of places like Nebraska and Iowa and North Dakota and South Dakota. And they move to places that are warmer and more friendly to you know, being outside and having recreational opportunities all year round for people as they age. Another demographic trend that's going along with this is that the population in the United States has been aging. The only thing that has kept us from not having negative growth in the United States has been immigration. But there are countries that the demographics are that they are experiencing negative growth as fewer and fewer people are actually having children in places like Finland, Norway, Sweden, and the Netherlands. They're experiencing negative
economic growth. Japan, actually, the government sets up like speed dating to try to have kids.
And the Chinese have actually ended their one-child policy. They ended that about, I think, 10 years ago. They have a two-child policy. And they're thinking about ending the two-child policy and letting people have as many kids as they want. Because if you want to continue to grow your economy, you have to have people. As people leave the work force, they're no longer productive. What causes an economy to grow? It's production, it's productivity of workers. There are a couple of ways you can get that. One is you can make workers more efficient, which we've done in this country, but there comes a point at which this ability to manufacture this knowledge on that device, it's only minimal incrementalism. It's not great leaps in incrementalism in terms of technology. You're still gonna have to have people that produce stuff to do.
It's kind of more just like a thought. I was thinking about demographics in like Oklahoma City and how the MAPS project has developed Oklahoma City a lot over the last 20 years. Are there a lot more people moving back into Oklahoma City? Because I know we were in a sports marketing class and one of the guys at the boathouse said that a lot of the people that would get degrees at OU, OSU, or UCO would get jobs in Texas, but a lot of them are actually coming back now.
So yeah, that's true. There is some movement back. One of the things that's happened is the quality of life indices in Oklahoma City has gone up significantly because we've done things like built Bricktown and we now have a professional sports franchise, which has allowed us to attract, by the way, a lot of industry. So our economy in Oklahoma City, when I moved here as a teenager, I was 13 years old, the biggest source of economic revenue for the state of Oklahoma was oil and gas followed by agriculture. And that we were basically a bimodal economy in this state. We had oil and gas and agriculture. Tourism was not a big deal because who the hell would want to come to Oklahoma? And now people actually do, and we actually get conferences to come to Oklahoma because Bricktown is so, you know, sort of attractive as a venue for mid-sized conferences. It's not for huge conferences like AMA, ICC, but it is for regional conferences and for regional stuff. We've also become hugely successful in recruiting medical technology companies to come into OMRF and that sort of medical technology core that we have off of Lincoln Boulevard. And so we've really diversified our economy, and that has been as a result of the fact that Oklahoma is better, it's not great compared to, say, South Texas in terms of the winters, but we're better than Nebraska. I mean, I've never had a bad Thanksgiving in Oklahoma. Generally, there are like 2 months out of the year that are really bad in Oklahoma in terms of our winters. It's late January and February. And by March, you'll even start getting some warm days. But I mean, generally speaking, November and even early December are generally pretty nice times of year in Oklahoma. It's cheap to move here. We have good educational, higher educational backgrounds in terms of our population, because we have lots of opportunities for that. And so we have seen a shifting in that. But what we've also seen is a shifting in terms of the population of Oklahoma is moved from western and northern Oklahoma to the vast majority, just like the vast majority of our population now lives within 600 miles of the coast. In Oklahoma, the vast majority of our population lives between that Lawton to Tulsa corridor on I-44.
Yeah. Since you said people are moving 600 miles from the coast, do you think, and I know that
Southerns usually have a lot of land, the Republicans, do you think there'll be a political shift where the people who live in the South, those Republicans, go more north, get away from everybody?
I don't know. I think what you'll see is, I think you're going to see in 1964, after Kennedy is assassinated and Johnson becomes president and wins the presidency in his own right, he passes the Civil Rights Act of 1964, and he does it by twisting. And he himself, Johnson, said, the Democrats, as a result of this, we will lose the South for a generation. And it's been more than a generation that they have lost the South. But it's starting to change.
Drastically.
It's starting to change. I mean, not here in Oklahoma.
Really?
Where we're the only state that has no county that voted for Barack Obama twice. But places like Georgia are starting to change, the demographics change. Florida is definitely changing. It was very strongly Republican for a long period of time, but as you had more Northerners move in, they tend to be more liberal and bring more liberal ideas. The Hispanic population in Florida was really interesting because they were overwhelmingly conservative compared to the rest of Hispanics because they were Cuban and not of South American or Mexican descent. And they tended to be more conservative than their other Hispanic counterparts in other parts of the country. But Cubans are no longer the largest Hispanic group in South Florida now. They used to be. Puerto Ricans and Mexicans now outnumber the Cuban population. And so that's changed the political demographics of places like Florida. And so you're seeing a bigger change. And I think you're going to see a bigger change in even places like Oklahoma. For example, Guymon now is the first Oklahoma town that became minority-majority. And it became minority-majority about 5 years ago. So as we have more and more immigration into the state, you're going to see a change.
I think Oklahoma had record numbers of blue voters after the whole teachers.
Yes, yeah. That has the
it's
whole
like
teacher strike has definitely changed the opinion of the Republican Party, I think, in Oklahoma. However, we're still going to elect, I think, a Republican governor
really
this time around. I don't think Drew Edmondson has much of a shot.
I was honestly thinking that Mick Cornett was going to be elected because he seems so modern.
I did.
Somebody from Tulsa runs, those people are highly motivated to get out and vote. And Mick Cornett could have won if he'd gotten Oklahoma City. Oklahoma City can dominate, but if there is somebody actually from Tulsa running, they have a tendency to turn out in higher numbers and be more motivated as voters in primary elections.
Well, Mick Cornett was more moderate, but he ran Oklahoma City and ran maps so efficiently and had so many audits. Like, I knew people that worked under him that were like, oh, he's going to get better because he's so great.
Yeah.
But then he didn't.
Once it went into a runoff, if he had won it in the first round, I think he would have been fine. But if he didn't get to the 50, I knew if he didn't get to the 50% plus one vote, he wasn't going to win it.
And stick through
so round. Yeah. I mean, you've gotten every vote you're going to get in that first round, and in the runoff election, he wasn't going to get it. So, demographics, again, you can get these from the Census Bureau, and you can get that's a rich form or rich source of information. Socioeconomic information is also provided largely by the Census Bureau, and so we can start marketing or basing market segmentations on socioeconomic factors. Who does that? Well, Rolex is a classic example of somebody that uses socioeconomic factors. Rolex does not want to sell. And I was in the Sam's Club and I noticed that they actually had a Rolex watch again. Rolex really was very troubled the first time that a Sam's Club got a Rolex. And the way they did it is Sam's Club has gone into jewelry stores that are closing out and they buy their inventory from these closeouts. And they would buy up, and so Rolex really went in, and they have a very strong sellback. If your jewelry store is going out of business, they want you to force you into selling back. But every once in a while, and they have one at the Sam's Club out here in I-35, a Rolex for sale, and Rolex absolutely hates that. They do not want to be sold in Sam's, and they do not want to sell watches to everybody. Right? That's Timex that wants to sell watches to everybody. Rolex uses socioeconomic segmentation to target. They are the largest manufacturer of fine watches. Are they the most expensive watch in the world? They're not.
There are brands that are more expensive than Rolex, but they are the number one most sort of iconic of the luxury watch market. And they protect that very, very assiduously, A, by not letting them be sold in Sam's to the extent that they can do that, and B, by raising their price year over year. It does not matter what is happening with the economy in any given country, which the United States is obviously the biggest country for marketing to Rolex, although other countries are emerging as being extremely valuable markets for Rolex. The Chinese have literally hundreds and thousands of millionaires now, and it's become very popular in China to have custom-made dress shirts that are an inch and a half cut, an inch and a half shorter on your left wrist than your right wrist, so that you can display your Rolex watch or your other fine Swiss luxury watch to everybody to see, and it's become a status symbol. But the United States is still the biggest market for Rolex. They try to very seriously focus on those socioeconomic groups that they want to target, and one way that they do it is it doesn't matter how bad the economy is in the United States or worldwide, Rolex raises their prices by 10%, a minimum of 10%, every single year, no matter what, in order to continue to maintain that sort of luxury, high-end edge. The most totally rich form of segmentation, and the highest and the most difficult to ascertain are probably, so you can get geographic from the sense, or you can get that obviously by looking at a map and sort of get sphere information on that, demographic and socioeconomic. Psychographics is a much more rich form, and I guess I'm out of time, so we'll stop there and pick up with that on Tuesday. I actually had some other more questions that you could answer than just the likes or up or down or hearts or cats on these, so we'll try and get to those on Tuesday.